and thank you all for coming. And I'll start with a quote. Although it has at all times given me an especial pleasure to behold your crowded assembly, and this place in particular has seemed to me to afford the amplest scope for action, the fairest stage for eloquence. Nonetheless, fellow citizens, this approach to fame, which the best have ever found most widely open, has hitherto been barred to me, not certainly by any wish of mine, but by that scheme of life which, from my earliest years, I had laid down for myself. When Cicero opened his speech, De Imperio Gnaei Pompeii, in 66 BC, he started by flattering his listeners. The view of the crowd of people in front of him was especially sweet to him, the place the most suitable for action and the most distinguished for eloquent oratory. Aside from the rhetorical point of flattery to sweeten his explanation of his past absence from the Contio, the popular assembly and its traditional meeting point in the Forum Romanum was a perfect setting for Cicero's message. Cicero spoke from the speaker's platform, the rostra, situated in the northwest corner of the forum and next to the Senate House. The rostra was so called because it displayed the ship's prows, which had been taken as trophy in the battle at Antium about 3 centuries earlier. The rostra itself, as well as its surroundings, reverberated with history and glorious moments in Rome's past. It was the ideal place for a speech about the future glories to be had, if the people would allow the brilliant general Pompeius Magnus to take on the command against Rome's arch-enemy, King Mithridates of Pontus. Tonight, I shall speak about Cicero and current research in Roman oratory. I shall start off by explaining a bit about the parameters of public speech in Rome, the venues, the education, and how Cicero's speeches help us to understand oratory in the Roman Republican setting. Then I shall discuss what other resources we have for studying oratory at Rome, giving a couple of specific examples along the way. Towards the end, I shall talk about current trends in the study of Roman oratory and where the field seems to be moving. Cicero will be central throughout, but not the only orator in the picture. The popular assembly, or the Contio in Latin, addressed by Cicero, had been called to the meeting by the tribune of the plebs, Gaius Manilius, who was also the proposer of the bill to accord the command to Pompeius. The Contio was an informal meeting convened by a magistrate or tribune, and anybody could attend. It was not a voting assembly, but instead a place for sharing of information, swaying of minds, and display of political credibility and oratorical ability. But the people was important, as they would vote on all proposals for law and in all elections for political magistracies. Cicero himself said later in his history of Roman oratory, called the Brutus, that the characteristic feature of the greatest orator is that he's considered the greatest by the people. The people mattered to the orator, and therefore to the politician and to the general, because these were the same people in Cicero's day. There were other oratorical venues at Rome. The Senate meetings would involve speeches, but only by senators, or sometimes foreign envoys negotiating with the Senate. The courts of law, taking place in the Roman Forum, would also require speeches by the prosecutor, the defense advocate, and character witnesses. For all of these venues, the orator had to know his audience, his message, and his style of delivery to make a persuasive impression. Oratorical skills did not come automatically with the task of speaking. It took years of education, first in Latin and Greek, then in theoretical rhetoric, and finally in oratorical practice. Only the elite could afford such an education, and this was one of the barriers against social mobility in ancient Rome. Cicero himself was not from the senatorial elite in Rome, but his father had had enough funds to afford the education of Cicero and his brother and to fund the social life to furnish the necessary networks for a political career. While many other newcomers in Roman politics decided to build their career on military activity, Cicero chose an oratorical career through the Roman courts. Starting off with defending clients in civil lawsuits, then in criminal lawsuits, Cicero moved up on the hierarchy of advocacy in Rome, making himself a name as a brilliant orator and making himself known to the electorate. He was elected to the junior magistracy of Quaestor in 75 BC and sent to western Sicily to administer that part of the province under the praetor in charge of all of Sicily. At the same time, he campaigned for election to the next magistracy, the aedileship. He took on the prosecution of a former governor of Sicily, Gaius Verus. Securing the conviction of Verus made Cicero the star of advocacy in Rome, and his election was secured for the aedileship of 69 BC. After that, he continued his advocacy, still only delivering speeches in the courts, until he was elected to the praetorship for 66. Also in 66, after years of studying rhetoric and oratory and of pleading in the Roman courts, Cicero finally chose, at the age of 40, to take on the next oratorical audience of the Congio and to deliver his speech on behalf of Pompeius' command against Mithridates. Cicero used this speech as a springboard towards a relationship with the Roman people, which he tried to nurture alongside his relationship with the senatorial elite, and not least to Pompeius himself. Cicero's speech on behalf of Pompey is famous for being his first speech in the Congio. It's famous for its portrait of Pompeius as a military genius endowed with virtue, prestige, and luck, and also for its oratorical brilliance. It illustrates what we all know about Cicero, that he was a great orator and that he used his oratory to further his and other people's careers. Over 50 of Cicero's speeches are still extant today. We know of about 80 speeches from mentions in other sources or even in his own works, and it has been calculated that he probably delivered double that amount, so more than 160 speeches throughout his career, which spanned 40 years as an advocate and a politician. Through these speeches and his correspondence and theoretical treatises on rhetoric, politics, and philosophy, we know more about him than about any other individual from antiquity. His works are also the reason for our detailed knowledge about the first century BC. His presence as a source, as well as a protagonist, is both a bonus and a problem. While he offers much information, he also dominates the field to such an extent that we tend to forget that his way of doing things is exactly his, and not necessarily that of others. His speeches have been used to support claims of general trends about speech frequency, speech structure, delivery, and many other aspects. And Cicero's steely focus on an oratorical platform for his political career has also misled. Scholars have been aware of the problem of representativeness, but with little possibility of countering Cicero's dominance. No other full speeches survive from the Republican period, and we only have a couple from the Imperial period. However, what we don't have in full, we have in fragments. Indeed, a great number of testimonies, descriptions of the activity of other Roman orators have survived, spread out over a multitude of texts. In the 20th century, one scholar set about collecting this evidence, and the result was the work which had proved indispensable for the past 80 years or so, Enrica Malcovati's Oratorum Romanorum Fragmenta, first edition, 1930, and the fourth edition, 1976. The Latin title Oratorum Romanorum Fragmenta, which translates into the fragments of the Roman orators, betrays its audience, namely the international community of specialist scholars working on Roman oratory, rhetoric, and politics. This work contains verbatim fragments and testimonies of Roman Republican orators in original Latin or Greek, and with notes in Latin. No translation or commentary in a modern language is offered and may not have seemed necessary at the time of the first edition. One reviewer, the famous ancient historian Ernst Badian, wrote in the Journal of Roman Studies in 1956 that there are few living scholars who more deserve the thanks of the readers of this journal than Professor Malkavati, whose care and acumen have salvaged far more from the wreck than would have seemed possible. Badian was absolutely right, because the work was the only way to seriously attempt to put Cicero's speeches into the context of other public oratory. Badian also pointed out a number of problems with this work, as a good reviewer must do. It quickly went out of print. It was increasingly inaccessible to a non-Latin and non-Greek audience, such as some school or university students. It also seemed to lack some information and to organize other information in a misleading way. Over the decades, these problems seemed more and more pressing, but difficult to deal with. Finding the resources to do something about the shortcomings of Malkavati's work was challenging, because dealing with the shortcomings would demand a complete rereading of all relevant ancient literature to find all references to Roman Republican orators, their public speeches, and the occasions at which they spoke, and to organize them systematically and in an accessible way. In other words, an enormous task not well suited to modern parameters of scholarship, with limited research time, limited funds for research assistance, and frequent demands for publications and results. Nevertheless, in 2012, the fragments of the Roman Republican Orators project started with funds from the European Union, not a word about Brexit, and is now entering its final stage. This project aims to collect and translate into English all fragments and testimonies of Roman Republican oratory, and thereby provide the raw material for generations of students and scholars interested in Roman oratory, rhetoric, political life, legal history, and many other aspects. The project team, including myself, has so far read through the works of more than 40 ancient authors, many of them authors of a large number of long works, and identified over 1,200 orators from the Roman Republican period. Some of these orators are only mentioned once, and we sometimes have no idea what they said, but 1,200 orators is nevertheless an enormous figure. And this tells us, in raw figures, how much we have lost and how rich an oratorical culture Cicero operated within. Let me give you an example, a passage taken from the 3rd century antiquarian, that is, a collector of interesting bits and bobs, Aulus Gellius, who had a particular interest in oratory. Gellius gives us, in one passage, three different passages, seemingly verbatim, from a speech delivered in circa 124 BC by Gaius Sempronius Gracchus. Gellius joins these passages together with further contextual information. And this is the passage. I provided it in translation so that it is accessible. I didn't give you the Latin translation here. Also, I wanted it to fit on the screen so you could actually read it and not just in minuscule font. I'll just read out the passage and note that there are no quotation marks of what is actually supposedly Gaius Gracchus's speech and what is Gellius commenting, but I hope you will be able to discern that through my analysis. When Gaius Gracchus returned from Sardinia, he addressed the people at Aconcio. These are his words. "I conducted myself," he said, in my province in the way that I thought would be most to your advantage, not in the way that I reckoned would serve my ambition. There was no cook in my household, no pretty slaves, and your sons were treated more respectfully at my table than in the general's tent. Later he says, I conducted myself in my province in such a way that no one can truly say that I took even a penny in gifts or imposed expense on anyone. I spent 2 years in my province. If a prostitute entered my house or any one slave boy was disturbed on my account, consider me the worst and lowest of all nations. Since I was so restrained with their slaves, you can decide how you think I lived with your sons. And then, after a gap, and so, citizens, when I returned to Rome, the belts which I had taken out full of silver, I brought back from the province empty. Others took out full amphorae of wine and brought them home full of silver. Let's take the caveats first. We don't know for certain whether Gellius, so the person who quotes this, had access to a written version of Gracchus' speech. But we do know that Gellius was generally good at quoting from his sources and that he had access to much more material than we have today. We also don't know at which stage Gracchus' speech was written down. It could have been immediately after his delivery, and Gracchus himself could have done it. But it could also have happened at a later date and by somebody else, thereby increasing the distance between delivered and written versions of the speech. But for the sake of my argument here tonight, let us assume that the written version was fairly close to the delivered one, and that Gellius quoted faithfully from that written version. Our speaker here, Gaius Sempronius Gracchus, was the younger brother of Tiberius Gracchus, who had been killed in office when tribune of the plebs in 133 BC. Tiberius Gracchus had angered a number of senators because his plans to reform the land distribution in Italy and his alleged disrespect for senatorial authority in politics. Gaius Gracchus, the younger brother, was already implicated in Tiberius's program as a member of the board overseeing this land distribution when he returned in 124 to Rome after his tenure as quaestor in the province of Sardinia. Upon his return, he was charged with disregard of duty because he did not continue his tenure under his governor, whose proconsular appointment had been extended. As a result of this action, this charging, he delivered a speech to the censors defending himself, a speech which we have attested in Cicero and the Greek biographer Plutarch, but also in a speech to the people in Aconcio. This is the one that's attested by Gellius, our speech. From Gellius's passage, it seems that Gracchus talked about his abstention from excessive expenditure, his abstention from accepting bribes of money and women, and from immoral behavior with young soldiers of the upper classes. It is no surprise that Gellius decides to refer to the most striking passages from this speech, namely, Gracchus's vivid and highly moralizing description of his own generosity. He entered the province with a full purse and left it with an empty one. And of his colleagues' gluttony and avarice. They had arrived with full wine jars, which upon departure was empty of wine. They had had drinking parties, but full of silver and gold, which they had taken from the provincials. Such a dramatic and well-styled description could easily have been used to strike at the corruption of the senators and show Gracchus as a man of high moral standards on a mission to decrease senatorial corruption. Underlying the allegations against Gracchus seem to have been a senatorial suspicion of his motives for returning early, namely to canvass for the tribunate, the office which his brother had had and in which he had been murdered. It seemed that Gaius also himself wanted to have this office. The sources report his tremendous popularity with the people, and the senators had not forgotten what his brother Tiberius had done in his tribunate, also with popular support. With this in mind, it is not implausible that Gracchus defended himself against the accusations and then used the opportunity to boost his own popularity with the people to present himself as an innocent victim of senatorial hostility. This speech also gave him a platform to articulate to the people and the electorate the unjust nature of the attacks on him, his personal qualities, and his political stance. So he turned a very negative situation into one which could be seen to reflect well upon himself. Now, much more can be said about this passage, its oratorical and rhetorical qualities, and its position within the history of Gaius Gracchus's life and career, and within the history of the late Roman Republic. But what I want you to take away is the richness of the non-Ciceronian oratorical material that is still extant. There's indeed a whole world out there of orators and their speeches which we can explore, analyze, and understand. Scholars have already begun the work of putting other orators into the picture. Cicero's archenemy, Publius Clodius, who is not on the screen because we don't have any ancient depictions of him. Publius Clodius was evidently eloquent and very able to get the Roman people on his side through persuasive speeches and a credible public persona as the people's champion. In fact, however convincing Cicero's speeches against Clodius may seem to us, their contemporaries were not necessarily persuaded. Not even after Clodius's death, those of you who are reading the Pro Milone, not even after Clodius's death, which is being discussed in the Pro Milone because Cicero is defending the alleged murderer of Clodius, even in that speech, Cicero has to fight almost the demon of Clodius. So Clodius is relevant throughout Cicero's career. Now we come to some of the people on the slide. Pompeius Magnus, Cicero's subject in the speech with which I opened my lecture, was not known to be a great orator, but nevertheless used public speech throughout his career to communicate his political and personal position. Julius Caesar, in the middle here, was considered the only contemporary of Cicero who could have rivaled him in eloquence had he wished not to focus on military career and his Gallic command. It was a choice for Caesar, a choice which others perhaps didn't have, including Cicero. Indeed, we can see that Caesar was both a highly eloquent speaker and a very tactical orator, knowing when to speak and what to say. Cato the Younger, the man who committed suicide to avoid Caesar's pardon, was a master of public relations, and he managed to present himself through oratory, dress, and behavior as a man of old-fashioned virtues, such as modest lifestyle, service to the state, and high morals. That he was also a pragmatic politician who did not shy away from theatrics and cheap tricks is only revealed if one takes a close look at his oratory and political career. In fact, the oratorical and political careers of some of Cicero's most prominent contemporaries show that Cicero's career is unrepresentative in several respects, and that brilliant oratory was not necessary for a successful political career. What was necessary for a political career in ancient Rome was the ability to deliver speeches in some form, because the political career choices made had to be articulated to the public in order to build up a credible public persona on which to base further career advances. Oratory was part of a larger nexus of ways in which to promote and communicate career choices and nurture future career advances. In the past 30 years or so, scholars have focused mainly on understanding the role of oratory in the political process in Republican Rome, and in particular, how oratory was used in the Contio. This focus has brought major insights into the workings of that popular assembly. Who could call meetings? Who could speak? How did the audience react? What was said? How many attended the meetings, and what was the conscious influence on political decision making? Especially the latter aspect has caused a great debate about the nature of the Roman state, because the Concio furnished the main communication point between the political leaders, magistrates and senators, and the people who elected them and voted on their proposals for legislation. This debate is not over, but it is clear that the current research into Roman oratory has a major bearing on how this debate is taken further. Another strand that has come out of the scholarly interest in the Concio is the study of oratorical performance and delivery. It is a difficult subject if based on textual versions of speeches delivered, but luckily we sometimes have descriptions of the ways in which orators delivered speeches and how they were received. One example is a passage in Cicero's rhetorical work, De Oratore, from 55 BC. In this work, Cicero sets up a dialogue between a number of prominent orators and politicians in 91 BC. And one of these is the consul of 95, Lucius Licinius Crassus, who mentions Gaius Gracchus's oratory and seemingly quotes a passage from one of Gracchus's speeches and explains how it was received. So I've given you here the translation from the relevant bit of Cicero's work, where he puts into the mouth of one of his interlocutors, one of the people in the dialogue, this particular passage. And the person in the dialogue then also quotes, seemingly quotes, Gaius Gracchus. So there are several layers in this particular passage. Gracchus is made to say by Cicero, "What was it about Gracchus, whom you, Catulus, remember better than I, that was talked about so much when I was young?" And there comes a quotation. "Where can I take refuge in my misery? Where can I turn? To the capital. But that is overglowing with my brother's blood. To home, so I can see my mother in misery, grief-stricken and downcast." And then comes Crassus in again. "People generally agreed that when delivering these words, he used his eyes, voice, and gestures to such effect that even his enemies could not contain their tears." This is usually thought to be a fragment of a speech which Gracchus delivered near the end of his life. He was murdered in 121 BC in a fashion not dissimilar to the one his brother had experienced 12 years earlier. And we think that he delivered this speech when he was aware of the great danger against him from both the Senate and the people. In this passage, Gracchus used all his oratorical talents to invoke compassion and sympathy. His ability to stir up emotion in his audience was well known. What is striking about this particular passage is the way that it is set in connection with his dramatic delivery. Gracchus's rhetorical technique has been termed dubitatio, which is defined as an attempt to strengthen the credibility of his own point of view by means of a feigned oratorical helplessness, which expresses itself in the appeal to the audience made in the form of a question for advice. So it seems that Gracchus was asking for advice about the next step in a literal as well as in a political sense. And the definition fits nicely with the helplessness and appeal expressed by Gracchus. Now, this helplessness is further emphasized by Gracchus's references to his brother Tiberius's violent death on the Capitol. His reference to his mother's grief at Tiberius's fate, might she experience a similar fate and a similar grief with the younger brother, and also emphasized implicitly in the fear of Gracchus's own impending similar fate should he not receive the support from his audience. He's begging for support, essentially. In his earlier speeches, Gracchus had referred to both Tiberius and to his mother in an attempt to deal with Tiberius's opponents, and also as part of his wider efforts to control and bank on his family's public image to nurture his own political profile. Everybody knew whom Gracchus was referring to in his speech, and all were invited to consider the enormous losses already sustained by his family and, in the spirit of empathy and perhaps even gratefulness to the family, to help and support Gracchus. This fragment combines Gracchus's strongest oratorical devices into one short passage. Emotional appeal, reference to his family's services, and a powerful delivery in expressions, voice, and gestures to go with the dramatic content. The effect on Gracchus's audience was powerful too, and it reached beyond and into what one scholar has called Gracchus's last day law, which is here recorded in Cicero, but also in Quintilian and other ancient orators, which seems to reflect an oral tradition about Gracchus's final days and his impressive oratory. So first an oral tradition, then later on written down so that we can see it. There are many things we still need to find out about Roman oratory, but with the addition of the fragments of the Roman Republican orators, it will be a much more straightforward process. It will, for example, be possible to study the ways in which particular speeches and speakers affected political action at specific occasions, the extent to which orators could make political claims in criminal trials, how far ideology played a part in Roman politics, whether there were competing cultural identities on show, and of course, how far Cicero is representative of Roman Republican oratory. Personally, I want to find out how later authors knew of and used Republican orators and oratory, and what this says about the state of oratory after the Republican period, that is, in the age of the emperors. In other words, I want to find out with what we can know about the period in the Republican period, but also how that is reflected immediately afterwards. We who are interested in Cicero and Roman oratory are therefore far from finished in our work, and there is new and very exciting stuff to find out. You may find that a lot of what I've said seems to suggest that Cicero is no longer relevant and should no longer be studied. That is not the case at all. While it is true that the more we know about Cicero's contemporaries, the more we are aware of Cicero's unique talents and unique position. But his speeches and his other works are treasure troves, not only of Ciceronian oratorical practice, but also about the intellectual and political culture in which it thrived, about the practice of other orators. Cicero is our largest source for other Republican orators and their speeches. And his works are also a treasure trove about Latin oratory and Latin language in the context of a Greco-Roman culture. In fact, there's still a lot of work to be done on Cicero. Many of his works still lack a serious commentary to elucidate the work, even if the past 20 years have seen an increase in these commentaries. At the moment, work is underway to write commentaries on his three speeches against a proposal for agrarian reform in 63, the so-called De Lege Agraria 1-3. Somebody else is working on Cicero's philosophical treatise, the Academica, and somebody else again is working on his youthful rhetorical treatise, De Inventionem. Other recent scholarship has focused on the networks around Cicero and Cicero's self-fashioning, that is, the ways in which Cicero presented himself to contemporaries and subsequent times through his letters, his speeches, his treatises, and through his public activity at Rome. Another recent trend in Ciceronian scholarship is to focus on the reception of Cicero. How did people after Cicero look back at him, think about him, and what did they know about him? I put here some of the more recent publications which look at specific aspects of Cicero's reception as a philosopher, as an orator, in the Middle Ages, in the early modern period. And just this month, this January, a new major research project has started in Amsterdam called Mediated Cicero, the Influence of Ancient Canonization on the Image of Cicero the Orator and Politician Since Antiquity. So that is really the most recent work being started on Cicero. Cicero continues to fascinate and intrigue. He had enormous influence on the Latin language, on theoretical rhetoric and practical oratory, on philosophical thought, and on the genre of letter writing. Through the mediation of the Middle Ages and the early modern period, Cicero has also influenced the English language. Humanity is derived from Cicero's humanitas. And he has also influenced the ways in which we expect orators to speak in a modern day, and I would say that Trump is going against those ideals in many ways. And he has also influenced the ways in which we think about how arguments should be constructed, both orally but also in written form. He has influenced the way in which we think about Greek philosophy because he has carried that through into Latin, and also what we think of as a letter, what we think this genre of letter really is. Indeed, his influence on Western civilization is not to be underestimated. I therefore hope you will continue your interest in Cicero, in Roman oratory and in politics, and in Roman history as such, because there's lots more to discover, and you can be part of it. Thank you.